You need to check out Crimson Blues.
Crimson Blues? What is that? Is that the name of a skin condition?
Woo, that's loud. Hi, Mom.
I have a major league buzz in the board.
I brought all my toys with me.
Test 1, 2.
Okay, you said something.
Oh!
What was that?
That's me.
There we got some bass.
How's the buzz? I think it's as good as we're gonna get.
Sounds pretty good here.
Sounds pretty good to me.
Is that buzzing in your headphone?
So Bullet Mike is special because the way that it amplifies is very bad, which is fantastic for harmonicas because we want as much trash as possible at every stage.
You want all that sharp edges and everything?
Yeah, we just want it all distorted and messed up.
I had played together with Bill, the drummer, in a previous band, a secular blues band. And we'd played together for a couple of months. And sometime later, he contacted me and said, "How would you like to start a Christian blues band?" And of course, I played kind of cool and nonchalant and said, "Oh yeah, that might be an interesting thing. We should mull that over. That might be a good thing to do. Let's think about it." And I didn't let on the truth, which was that I was very anxious actually to do something like that, and that's what I wanted to do more than anything else.
Works for me.
But he brought in June and Rich because he'd played with them in the past. I brought on my guitar buddy Brad, who I knew from my church. When I told him that we had this Christian blues band project in the works and told him that he was my first pick if he was interested, he instantly jumped on it and said, "Count me in, count me in," without hesitating for even a second to think it over. My approach to songwriting is a little bit odd. At least I think it is. I'm not sure what other people do for songwriting, but this is what happens for me, which is the ideas for songs come just from a sound or a tone or a musical groove or you know, some riff, something of that sort. It's like a guitar, the tone of a guitar sounds a certain way, and a certain really cool blues lick sounds a certain way with a certain guitar tone. It will invoke some feeling within me, and then the feeling in turn triggers the idea for the song. And then the specific lyrics of the song will tend to sort of just fall out of my head, sometimes in 10 to 15 minutes in its entirety, other times a little more gradually over the course of a day or two. A great example of that. One of our early practices when we just got started as a band, Bill is just doing some kind of cool rhythm pattern on the drums. Everybody jumps in to jam with him because it's fun. I do too. And then the words pop into my head. Sanctified Boogie Blues. And week later, I come back for next practice, and I've got the words to the song written, and off we go. To do is take old retro songs from many decades ago, summer blues classics, summer blues songs that aren't well known, but we take them, we bring them forward, we juice them up, we rock them up, energize them. A lot of these songs have really powerful messages in them. They have a lot to say. The messages in some of these songs are timeless.
And when we say righteous, we mean it in the right way, right? Yeah.
Can you move over just a little bit, Brad? Brad, can you move over just to here?
I want
to
get it.
Yeah, there you go. Could totally block him, yeah.
Just for all the recorders, this is take number X.
Yeah.
Tape X, there you go.
All right.
Take 3005.
I had gotten laid off from a job. Had spent about a month job hunting. Thankfully, the Lord provided I got a new job. That turned out okay. But during that time, I had to deal with the anxiety and concern and, you know, wondering what's going to happen. And I had to kind of decide, do I just say that I trust God? Do I claim that God is good? Or do I really truly believe it even when times are bad? Even if things don't turn out right? What if we lose the house? Is God still good? I had to really think that through. And I ended up actually writing this song, One Way Ticket. I wrote this song as a way to remind myself that, hey, Mark, yeah, you do need to trust God even if circumstances are bad. If things don't turn out the way you like, God is still good.
All right, everybody dance just like he's doing.
That I was trying to teach myself this lesson by writing this song.
We're going to slow it up a little bit here. Do something a little introspective, something...
There's a song called, You're Gonna Need Somebody on Your Bond. And it was written by Blind Willie Johnson. He was a preacher and a gospel blues musician back in the 20s, 30s, 40s.
This song was written a long time ago when your grandparents were babies.
There's a reason they called him Blind Willie Johnson, is because he really was blind.
And in this song he says, you're going to need somebody on your bond.
He fell on a lot of hard times, and he lived most of his life in poverty. and he wrote some gospel blues songs that are amazing to this very day. This particular one of his that we do, it's a gorgeous, gorgeous song. The way we play it is not that different from his original arrangement. Bill had had a schedule conflict, couldn't make an event that we wanted to go do. Next thing I know, after that was done, Bill is saying to me, "You know, Mark, the Allman Brothers used two drummers. Did you know that?"
Yeah, okay.
He says, and Mark, the Doobie Brothers, they have two drummers. And I start saying, what's your point, Bill? You trying to tell me something here? He says, "Well, you know, if we had two drummers, we could have this fuller sound. And I'd have a little flexibility, like if I wanted to do congas or something like that, I could do that."
Well, yeah, going from just maybe jamming with you once to going and playing a full-on concert down at Pismo and trying to learn all your songs, and especially, you know, Sanctified blues and the way Bill plays it. I says, "Boy, I was beating the dashboard in the car for days trying to figure that out."
Yeah, I still haven't figured it out.
I still play it my own way. I just kind of make it sound like that. Yeah.
So we have a little more flexibility with the two drummers. If one of them has a schedule conflict, we can still do a gig with the other drummer. In those venues that allow us to fit both drummers in, we have a really nice full sound. I took kind of a wait-and-see attitude at first. I said, "Well, okay, you know, we'll give this a try. But, you know, not all drummers sound good together."
Yeah. And then the idea of double drumming in. And I remember sometimes in the past trying to do it. Sometimes it's a challenge, but shoots with Bill. I mean, it's a great blend. Great blend. I enjoy playing with him. And the several concerts we've done, you know, it seems like there's good audience reaction to it. You know, they get to watch two guys up there moving around. What's that guy doing? What's the other guy doing? You know, and then of course Mark gets to introduce, you know, the special surprise of extra drummers hiding up on the platform.
Yeah, they're hiding where no one can see them.
Yeah. I think it's great. It's great to hear two different style drummers. You guys complement each other, play off each other, and it also adds a measure of stability.
These two kind of locked in really nicely, though. Almost instinctively, there are certain tunes where Bill kind of takes the lead and Scott follows him, and then there's other tunes where Scott kind of takes the lead and Bill follows him. It worked out well.
kind of audiences that we love to play for the most is folks in, say, like a recovery program. Folks who have hit rock bottom, and for them, pursuing the Christian faith is not just, it's not just like a religious country club for them. For them, it's a real life and death struggle. We're talking about people facing adversities that I can hardly begin to imagine. People who, when they are leaning on Jesus Christ to help them through insurmountable challenges, they aren't kidding. They really mean it.
Anybody with a heart condition, best have your medicine ready. Just saying.
We've been hitting you guys with some new songs, and I hope you liked them.
For whatever reason, Christian blues resonates really well. And I think the fact that people in 12-step programs have been encouraged to stop hiding from their feelings, because a lot of times addiction is rooted in trying to escape feelings. These folks are not hiding from their feelings, which means they're very candid and open about their feelings. That means when they get excited about some uplifting music that resonates for them, well, they get really, really excited. Some of these recovery crowds get so energized and so pumped up. We, in turn, get energized and excited and pumped up. And we love playing for them. There's no other audience like that. Blues music seems to fit their demographic. I don't know why, but it just does. The brutal honesty of blues songs about the fact that life is really hard, the challenges are really tough. The hope that comes from a Christian blues song that says, Jesus Christ is the one who will help you through that hard time.
Don't they just make you feel just spirit-filled right now?
I want you to make a little noise, get some love and affection for Brad Marsh on the guitar there, and he'll play some blues guitar for you. Come on, give him some noise you can hear. What?
Yeah. I can live in this world.
In the middle of the night, you don't say nothing to him, you don't look him in the eye. You let him tune your guitar, though the strings are buzzing tight. And he has the guitar to you, you go down without a fight. I
Oh good grief. I give up.